Well, I first met him by reputation because I read his book, Life in the Universe, written with the Soviet astronomer Shklovsky. That was written in the late 60s, and I read it sometime in around 1970, 71. So I certainly knew Carl by reputation, and then as a summer student in Puerto Rico at the Arecibo Observatory, he and several other Cornell faculty came to the observatory explicitly to talk to the summer students. So that's when I first met Carl, and there were a number of us staying off in a fairly primitive shack in the jungle, and we invited him over, and he came over and talked with us one night. I think I encountered him at the observatory again in around 1975, 76, when he and Frank Drake were doing a SETI program. And I remember Carl and Frank sitting in the control room looking at a very old school spectrometer, wanting to see in real time signals coming from a civilization around another star. And I thought this was a little ironic because during that summer of 1973, that was during the Watergate hearings. And so the summer students were all listening to the Watergate hearings using that same device. But it really wasn't until the early 90s when we started to talk about, joint interests in science, and those focused on SETI. And the reason for that was Carl had worked with Paul Horowitz on Paul's long-term SETI program that went for 5 years. It was called META, the Mega-Channel Extraterrestrial Assay. And it was very innovative for its time because they scanned the sky multiple times, looking at a lot of different frequencies and so forth. And after doing something like 10 trillion statistical tests, and ruling out all kinds of potential signals, there were a few dozen that remained. And Carl was very enthused about this, really wanting to be sure that he really would like these to have been real. But it's one of these things where it's very hard to assess because those signals did not repeat. So we got talking along with a graduate student, one of my graduate students, Joe Lazio, about the role of interstellar scintillation, which is a phenomenon that we know very well from pulsar work. And so I had worked on that phenomenon quite a bit. But what that can do is it can make a signal intermittent. And so we talked about this for quite a while and started working on a paper, and that actually took a couple of years to write that paper. And it was during that time, actually when the paper was being reviewed, that Carl passed away. So it really came out a few months after he had passed away. It was a real privilege to work with Carl on that because it was Carl for one thing, but also his enthusiasm for the subject and wanting to know what are the things involved with potential signals coming from other civilizations.
I arrived in 1974, and Carl was already here, and he was already quite famous. Even though this was before Cosmos, he was well known as a popularizer of science. And I remembered having discussions with my colleagues in the physics department who were very skeptical about Carl as a scientist. They felt that, he couldn't be a serious scientist if he spent all this time popularizing the subject. And I thought this was a little strange attitude because there's a long record of very famous scientists who've been popularizers. Very soon after I arrived, within a few months, I got put on the PhD thesis committee of one of Carl's students as a minor member. And the student was Owen Toon, and his thesis was about the atmosphere of Mars, and in particular, the effect of dust storms. And this was very far removed from general relativity, which was my subject. Since I worked in theoretical astrophysics, the techniques for studying the propagation of radiation in the Martian atmosphere were very similar to the techniques that I knew about for propagation of radiation in the atmosphere of stars. So I ended up on the committee. And I was extremely impressed. I mean, this was a really very technical thesis, went into great detail, and it was clear that during the thesis defense that Carl had a complete mastery of all the technical aspects of the subject. And so I certainly, since then, anytime someone would make some sneering reference about Carl couldn't be a serious scientist, I was very quick to put them down.
The way the National Academy of Sciences treated Carl was a lasting stain on them, because he absolutely did have the scientific credentials, the scientific achievements. He put in the hard work and really did add to our understanding of Venus and Mars and so much else, and Earth, so much else. Why was he penalized? Because there was this evil spell cast over the community of science, which said, we are a priesthood, somehow apart from the rest of society. I'm so proud of Carl. I'm so grateful to Saul for singling out that aspect of Carl's life and work that is all too often ignored.
As a postscript to this story, a few years later, the famous Nuclear Winter paper came out with Carl and Owen Toon as part of the author list. And that actually used the science that was developed in Owen's thesis.
We worked for a couple of years, Carl and Steve and I, on creating a series which would be not only about the physics of the atom and the nucleus, but also the history of science and our deepening understanding of, you know, penetrating this inner sanctum of matter, first predicted by Democritus, the great pre-Socratic philosopher of genius. And then the history, not only of the science, but of the nuclear arms race. So when we were working on this, it was a period in which Carl was also working on Nuclear Winter, but it was a period when the Soviet Union and the United States had some 60,000 nuclear weapons. So it felt like the whole Earth was a hostage drama to the superpowers. And, you know, a planet rigged with 60,000 nuclear weapons, which were administered by a species that is known for its imperfections, for its mistakes, for its sloppiness, a species that has had roughly a million years experience with fire and still having lots of issues with that. And so we wanted to tell the story of the whole thing. We got very far. We got to the point where we had a major network that was going to finance it. And we were very excited. We'd spent years working on it. And in during a meeting with that network, a note was passed to the director of the network that told us that the Russians had just shot down a Korean airliner, actually killing a member of Congress who happened to be on board. And that was the end of that project.
I started working in 1969 with Tommy Gold, and it was very interesting and I liked it very much. But my path crossed with Carl Sagan too, and Carl Sagan was always looking for chemists for certain projects, and I talked to him quite a bit, and he was always interesting to talk to. He was somebody who was worth knowing by all means. I went to one or two of his classes, and I really was very impressed how he was very talented speaker altogether, and he used that talent for his teaching, and it worked very well. I became the administrative head of the center, and my office was on the first floor of the building near the entrance door. So as people went to their offices taking the elevator, usually they had to come by my office. So, and I had an open door, and they usually stopped to chat a little. Carl was very good that way. We were near neighbors. His house and our house by 5 minutes foot by foot from each other. And we had him over. I don't remember if it was dinner or not, but I see us on our big terrace sitting and talking about all kind of things. He was a terrific speaker, and his heart was in it. He really did what he was extremely good and interested in, and that's how I see him in front of me.
Well, he had a tremendous respect and affection for Elizabeth. I hear stories of, you know, one guy wrote me and said, I have a job at Johnson Space Center, and one day my mother is in an elevator somewhere in Texas, and Carl is in the elevator, and he's going to a meeting, and my mother summons up all her courage, and she says, I'm so excited to meet you, Dr. Sagan. My son works at Johnson Space Center. And Carl says, what does your son do? And she says, I'm so embarrassed to tell you this. I really don't know what he does. And Carl gets off at her floor and he goes, well, tell me what his title is. And Carl spends about 5 minutes explaining to this woman why what her son does is so significant and vital to the space program. And then he gets back on the elevator, goes to his meeting. That was Carl. Someone who was always ready to communicate. Someone who had not an ounce of any kind of snobbery or self-importance, but who could really connect with all of us. So proud of that aspect of him.
He was a good person, which is very rare, especially with people who become very well known. But he was.